Yeah, I know it's already late January, but hey, nobody has seen me in almost a month, so I just had to say it. I hope all of you had a great time and also hope that all of you are ready to give it all this year with your hobby, and I'm going to be here backing you up with some tutorials along the way. The number one question I get asked the most is, what kit should I use to practice? Well, it's not a hard question, but the answer is tricky. The best kit you can work on to get your first GK done is not so small, but not so big. Something in the middle with less than 20 pieces and few areas to mask. I have some examples here of some kits that I have that I consider great for beginners. Let's take this Ai Sakataiga kit. She's a 1/6 scale, but looking at it, it's really small due to the character nature. She's really short in the anime, so you will need to be careful when choosing your character as well. She has less than 20 parts, not too many places to mask. You can paint her skirt and mask it easily. Same with the arms, her legs, and the hair, as it's just 2 pieces. Another 1/6 scale kit you can use is this Yuki no Miyazawa. In the anime, she's not so short, so this scale is somewhat accurate. The same scenario with the pieces, very few need to be masked, and it also has less than 20 pieces. Let's talk about scales for a moment. Even though, as you saw the kits I showed, they were the same scale. One looks like a 1/8 scale, not exactly very big, so the scales are determined depending on the character and how tall it is supposedly in real life. Also, the sculptors have a very different take on scales. You can put 2 different sculptors to make the same character, but the sizes will be out of whack when they finish. So 3 things to keep in mind: sculptors, actual height of the character, and the supposed scale. Interesting fact is that this Yoko figure in particular was indeed made with 2 different scales and sold that way. So don't be surprised if you see her in both 1/8 and 1/6 scale kits. I think it's great for options, don't you think? Back to topic. Now that scales are clear, let's take this kit here as an example of what not to practice on if you're just starting. This is a 1/8 scale figure of Miku. She's small, but oh my god, does she have a shitload of pieces. Counting them all, she has a total of 46. And with all these pieces, they are tiny and very, very fragile. Many of them will break, as you see here, and some will need a higher level of experience when puttying and putting together and also masking. Another kit I don't recommend you choose is a 1/10 scale or a 1/20 scale. It's usually really small and sometimes just 3 pieces or less, which is good and bad. Good because it's just 3 pieces. Bad because you need to mask a lot. So instead of these kits, try some SD versions that have around 5 to 8 pieces, but much easier to work on. Here are a few examples of SD kits that I can show you. Topic. Sanding. Oh, what's that that I hear? Pfft, sanding? We all know how to sand. Oh yeah? Well, oh, so what if you can sand? Bunch of party poopers. But did you know that there is a right way and a wrong way of sanding, even if you think that it's a no-brainer? Sanding requires a certain knowledge and several sandpaper grit numbers. For example, I have a variety right here, starting from 220 up to 1000. I cut my sandpaper in little squares for convenience. Instead of just cutting little by little on each sheet, I only have extra sheets of files in my files on my file holder. Get it? Files? File holder? No? There. Moving on. So you have a file for each type of seam line. The bigger and prominent ones require a lower grid, like a 320. You need to sand perpendicular to the seam line. You also need to be very careful when you have details, as you might sand them off if you sand horizontally. After sanding with the lower grid, start your way up to the next one and so until you have a smooth finish. You could also polish it with a 1000 grit paper. This way you remove the seam and you have a seamless area that didn't require putty, unless there was an area where the seam went down under the surface. You can just add a little bit of putty and sand it off later. Now let's move on to pinning. I had explained on my Sailor Cosmos whip on how you can pin when it was too difficult to get it right. But this is another way of pinning when you have no guide pins and you need to keep the pieces together correctly without sliding. Take your Dremel and literally drill through the piece to get an exact fit. This works great when you don't have any details on the piece that you're drilling through, in this case an arm or a leg. But it doesn't end there. The next step is to make your own guides so that your pieces can stay in place. What I do is take a round tip drill for engraving and make my own on both pieces. This way you can add the putty onto one of the pieces so that the putty can have more area to stick onto, and then just add Vaseline on the other piece. Press, remove excess putty, and leave it to dry. When it does dry, you will have two pieces that fit flawlessly, as you can see in this other piece from another kit that I had the same issue with the joint. The last trick in my bag, at least for this tutorial, is how to repair broken fingers. Don't you ever get pissed when you receive a kit that has broken pieces, especially little tiny ones? Well, the secret is to start with one piece at a time. In this case, you have several broken parts from one piece. This arm came with two broken fingers. To repair it, you need to attach one piece at a time and wait until you repair the first one to start with the next. What I do is take a micro drill bit and use the smallest one, which is a 0.02mm one, and drill through the finger to get a small pin to go through the two pieces. This way you have a better attachment. Take a slightly bigger drill and drill on the other bigger piece enough to be able to fill it with putty or glue. Then take your smaller one with the small pin, and in this case I used Zap-A-Gap glue and I was able to connect them and they're all set. To finish up with any imperfections in the connection itself, put a little putty on it. I use Mr. Dissolve Putty as I can have a better control over it with a small application. And since it's liquid, it can fill in the micro gaps left behind, if any. After it dries, I just used a 360 grit sandpaper and carefully sanded the excess putty, then move up to a 400 grit to finish the job. The result is having a very strong connection and with no danger of falling off in the future, contrary to just applying glue without any support and then having it fall off. You will get frustrated and pissed if it happens after you finish painting your kit. I speak from experience, so take my word for it. So there you have it. Some more stuff from my bag of tricks. I hope it helps and I hope you had fun as well. I had mentioned earlier that I was in need of some extra money to save for some equipment. So I just want to put out there that I am selling this set of kits from Sailor Moon. The base was made from zero and these are also original casts. It's a set so I can't sell them individually. So if you're interested in purchasing and contributing to the cause, as all proceedings of this sale will go for these equipments that I'm in need of. Drop me a line either here or on my Facebook, and you can also check out my website. As always, don't forget to subscribe and visit my Facebook page. Give it a like and you will see more of my work as I go on live. Sometimes I do show what I'm doing, so all the links can be found in the description area. So for now, see you next time, my risen monkeys! This kit is a 1/6 scale kit. Wait, that's not right. You can paint her hair and mask it easily. No. Sizes will be out of whack. When they fin- Okay. understand this post scale. I have to breathe at a certain moment in time. And some will need a higher level. And some will need a higher level of.